last interview, and he's right now with the IRS, and he has taken a break for a year, and right now he's with us, and he will be talking to you and sharing his experience with you. And after his particular session, I think you can also feel free to have a set of one-on-ones done with him, and we can take it on also as per how you want to take it further. All right, he'll be with us till 1 o'clock, and based on how you want what kind of questions you want to ask him and how he wants to talk to you, accordingly you can plan the session. All right, thank you.
Morning.
So, ma'am, saying, I'll give you a brief introduction of who I am and where I'm from. My name is Ramit. I'm basically from Kerala, but I was born and raised in. Am I audible to all? So, I was born and raised in Delhi. I did my schooling there in St. Columbus. School very popular because that's where Shankar studied. Just for me, sake. And then I went to Kerala. I did my engineering there. I'm a computer science engineering graduate. And post my college, I got a few jobs through campus recruitment. But I was not at all interested in getting into the IT industry. And the reasons are obvious. So that's when I decided, okay, I was into like social service and all. So I thought, okay, why not try civil services? I put forward this idea to my parents. And the so-called liberal-minded parents that I got, luckily, they were, you know, readily accepted my proposal, and they said, okay, why don't you try it? At the end of the day, this is your life, you live it the way you want to. So then I decided to prepare. My first attempt came when the year they cut off CSAT, made it basically just a sort of namesake examination for all of us, especially South Indians. If at all I have to call, you know, it's a disadvantage for us, it's obvious. My next attempt, I gave my mains, I couldn't clear. So third attempt, I eventually managed to clear, which was my first interview as well. So that's my journey. And interview, the popular perception says that interview is the toughest part. But for me, I always had this thing in me that interview is going to be the easiest one. Easiest does not mean that it was easy. It was just easiest compared to the other two parts of civil service examination. So I believe some of you have already attempted the interview, isn't it? Could you raise your hand? So how was your experience before? So what was your scores before? Earlier? Like, were you able to score really high?
I
if you were. It's one of the same.
195.
Oh, so that's really a good, it's a really good score. And was that the only interview attempted?
Yes. Okay.
So the others?
They got 150.
Acha. Only once?
Yes.
Like, have you been to the interview only once? Others?
150.
So there are some, often I've met people who've managed to score 200 in one interview and gone straight down to 120, 130 to the other. And they are also baffled. They also don't know as to what happened. It just sort of, majority of the people would say that interview being subjective should actually be cut off, just like how the government did recently, took a decision for some services when the interview has been cut off. But personally, on, you know, my personal suggestion would be that interview is that platform, or as we call it, personality test, PT is that platform, wherein you actually get to express yourself. Okay, compared to prelims and mains, you have a restrictive space, right? Whereas for personality test, there is no restrictions whatsoever. All they expect you to do is speak. Speak up. That's all. They want to know us. Correct. Right now, when I entered this room, you had no idea as to what I am. You might have heard my name. You might have seen my face in photographs. That's all. But when I interact with you for the next 2 to 2.5 hours, you will get to know more about me because I am the one speaking. Correct. So there is a certain part of me that I'm going to reveal to you. That is me. So that is exactly what happens in the PT as well. Whatever you speak out, whatever information that you give out about yourself to the interview board and in general, that is the impression that you're going to create. Okay, so the entire interview is in your hands. That is the reality. The entire interview, whatever sort of question that they ask, the ultimate result results in what comes out of your mouth, isn't it? So you can drive it the way you want to. If you believe that you are weak in a certain section, let's say your graduation. Like for instance, when I went for my interview, it had already been 3 years since I had, you know, passed out of my college. So I wasn't very great in my engineering graduate subject. But I knew that, you know, I was good in, like I said, I'm a computer science engineering graduate. So I was good in practicals, but I wasn't that great in theory. So I was a little bit, you know, concerned, you know, in case they ask me questions related to my graduation, I might be pushed to the corner. But I was confident that even if that happens, I'll somehow sway the entire interview into my favor. Okay. At least I have that confidence. So my interview date was on April 19th, which is like towards the fag end of the last year's interview process. Before the actual dates were released, which I believe in this year's case would be released in a couple of days, isn't it? So I had this thing in my mind that I want my interview at the end. Had it been in the beginning, I don't know, the results could have been different. But anyway, thing is that I really wanted it to be in the end. So I am a sort of personality, my own character, telling you about me. I like to look at the positive side of things. Okay? Whatever happens, I like to seek out, even if something really negative happens, I'll be down for a few hours, few days maybe. But eventually my mind somehow plays tricks with myself into believing that there's always something positive out of it. So my interview date happened to be April 19th. So I was like thinking, what is so positive about it? So I don't know how many of you people watch Malayalam movies. There is an actor called as Balendra Menon. She might know. He's a very popular actor come director. He's into everything. He's like, you know, the Farhan Akhtar of Bollywood. He had a movie called April 19th back in, you know, it was released in 1990s. And it was a super hit. So for me, the way I looked at it was, since April 19th movie was a big hit, this day is going to be it for me. That is the force that drove me during the initial days. So I think the dates were declared on Jan 17th last year. So I had almost, what, 3.5 months ahead of me to prepare. So I started asking questions. What should I prepare and how should I prepare? Interview, it's ultimately personality test. It's my personality that's going to be tested. What is it that I'm going to portray there? So one of the most important things that I've done during those three and a half months was I used to kind of, you may call it meditation in a way, but I didn't term it in, you know, term it meditation back then. But I used to sit in my room on my chair, and almost for every day, consistently every day, 10 to 15 minutes, I used to just sit, close my eyes, and imagine me going for the interview. I used to just sit and imagine. Imagine questions that they might ask me, and these were very general questions that used to pop in my head, not at all related to current affairs, just random questions, anything. You know, they could ask me about my father, my mother, my brother, my background, my school, anything. But it was that picture that kept, you know, solidifying in my mind. So I kept thinking about it. I used to imagine different kinds of people sitting as chairpersons of the board, women, men. Some from the military background, some from some other background, IAS officers, IPS officers, so different people. So this is how I used to sit and visualize how it's going to help me. This kind of gave me the confidence that, you know, I can sit for the interview, one. Secondly, remember I initially mentioned, in public perception, interview or personal test happens to be the toughest one. Yes or no? Correct. Whereas for me, the way I looked at this was, we've all prepared, you know, putting our heart and soul into this, correct? If we start fearing the personality test, isn't this the day that we've been waiting for? Yes or no? All this effort, all this, you know, the so-called effort that we put into, all these years of experience that we've had preparing, all of this has been this for this one particular day, when we get to portray ourselves in front of the board, in front of the UPSC board. So why should we fear that? Correct. So it's going to be something very beautiful to describe it in one way, when I get to interact with, you know, seniors, very senior people, and express myself. So I have a friend called Mr. Abraham Wren. He is also in the IRS. He is very senior to us. He is 2014-15 batch. So you all have heard of Miss Alka Sarumi, I guess. Some of you might have already sat in her pool, and people are terrified of her. She, when I went for my foundation course, she was the chief guest for our final day as well. So she is always, you know, known as a terrifying lady because she hardly gives very good marks. So this individual, this gentleman, Mr. Abraham Rell, managed to score more than 200 twice in her board in two consecutive years. So he's a close friend of mine, so I sat with him one day, so I asked him, what is it that, you know, clicked for you? So this is what he told me. He said, first of all, one of his hobbies was analyzing football tactics. Okay, it's a very unique hobby, analyzing football tactics. This is what his hobby was, one. And second was quizzing in football. So you wouldn't believe, this is what she did. She, when he came and sat in front of the board, she had her laptop open and she Googled five questions related to five individuals over a period of 100 years in football, because he had mentioned quizzing in football, okay? And luckily, you know, it was out of pure luck that he managed to answer all five of them. This was his first interview, okay? So he managed to answer all five of them, despite the fact that she had no idea about football, no idea whatsoever. She wasn't really fond of football as such, so she had to Google it up. So you can imagine the kind of, you know, pressure that we might face when you realize that the chairperson is sitting in front of you and has the laptop open with the Google open, and she might ask questions from any part of the world. Okay. So luckily he was able to answer all five of them. From then on, he said the rest of the interview she didn't even care. She just sat there because he managed to impress her first and foremost. First of all, because she is the person, or the chairperson of the board is the one who gives marks eventually for us. The other board members can give suggestions, that's all. Okay, they don't put marks. They might suggest to the chairperson that, you know, so many marks could be given to this so-called candidate. But ultimately, if you manage to impress the chairperson, that's all. That's all you want, okay? And most importantly, he said, listen, the people who are sitting in the panel, they might be more or less of your grandfather's age. Yes or no? Correct. Okay. So, how do you speak to your grandfather's or grandparents' friends? How do you speak to them? You give them a certain amount of respect. Yes or no? Because of their age, they are our grandparents' friends. But at the same time, you have a certain friendliness in your relationship, in your interaction with your grandparents. I'm pretty sure all of us who had interactions with our grandparents, we are more free with them than our own parents. Yes or no? Correct. We can tell them even about, you know, even the most secret lives of our, the biggest secrets of our lives. We can even share our, you know, crushes or about our girlfriends and boyfriends with them, but maybe not with our parents. Yes or no? Correct. That's the relationship that most children have with their grandparents. But at the same time, we'll always give them the respect. Yes or no? So he said, visualize yourself as sitting in front of your grandparents' friends. So naturally, one, you won't disrespect them. You definitely have a certain amount of respect. But at the same time, you'll be friendly with them, which is exactly what you want. They want this to open up. When you go, those people who have already gone, you might have even been offered, you know, chai, coffee, tea, whiskey, whatever. Yes or no? I don't know. Some lucky people do get that. Okay? So I wasn't offered anything. Some people are offered chai, coffee, would you like to eat something, how is your journey, you know, that's how they begin the conversations. So this is one of the biggest questions that stuck in my head. So I from that day onwards, I thought, okay, so basically I'm going to interact with people who may be regarded as my grandparents' friends, so I can have a sense of friendliness with a sense of respect to the matter. So they won't feel that I'm, you know, sitting in a very casual interview. But at the same time, I have given UPSC the seriousness that it deserves, the respect that it deserves. So that's how my journey began, with my UPSC interview personality test practice. And from then on, I was pretty confident. I was, all my mock interviews, they all said I'm very pleasant to talk to. But I have a, you know, I had a lot of problems as well, which I rectified as and when, you know, they came about, as and when they were spotted by my own seniors as well as the academy, the mock interview panels. I didn't sit for 2 minutes. I sat for almost 3 mock interviews and 2 to 3 informal mocks. Informal mocks are where you sit with your own seniors, you know, on one-on-one discussion, and they ask questions and they evaluate how you answer the questions. Ultimately, they don't look for right or wrong answers, UPSC. That's the biggest myth that we follow. They don't look for right or wrong answers. They always look for an answer. They expect an opinion. They expect an answer. That's all. I had 23 questions, if I'm not wrong, out of which I said I don't know to almost 3 to 4 questions. I didn't know the answer. In fact, I gave a wrong answer to a question. My option subject is Pavan. And under pressure, they actually asked me what is the difference between same self and bureaucracy. I actually, gave a wrong answer to that. Then they asked, even with the other way, I said, yes, ma'am, I'm sorry, I got under pressure. They all smiled. They said, yes, that is what we accept. You have to be under pressure. For those of you who already gone, you might know, even when you sit for your mock interview, the toughest yet the most beautiful part of your interview actually is the 5 minutes that you sit outside. You will have a chair like this. This will be the room, the door. You will sit here waiting to see the tenant. That is the feeling that you get. Okay? So your heartbeat would cross 200, 300, 400 per minute. You'll be just sitting there waiting for the door to open until you're called to come. And it won't come. It will feel like eternity. Why aren't you opening the door? Why? What is it that, you know, the person sitting who has gone before me is he so interesting? Is he or she so interesting that they're taking so long? Why can't they just get it done with? You'll feel all kinds of, you know, questions throbbing in your head. It'll be questions. It'll be very difficult to find answers to them. So the tune who took me to that seat. So I have this thing that I love interacting with people. Okay? I have this thing for interacting with people. And I was telling Nam earlier that I have this thing with language as well. Because I like languages. So that lets you interact with people a lot. So what I do is, to ease off her pressure, whoever I meet, during the entire process of submitting our documents and then interacting and coming to the waiting room, there's a big round hall where you sit and wait, and then you're brought onto this beautiful chair, okay? So during that process, I used to interact with as many people as possible, and not my interview colleagues. I used to interact with the people who work there. You know, the pure room who took me there, his name was Deepak, I still remember. So I kept interacting, all these questions I used to ask them. So it used to ease my pressure, and he would also feel good.
Yes or no?
He would also feel, in North India, and I shouldn't be saying this, it's very wrong, but they have this thing that, you know, so-called IAS, IPS officers are rabblers. You know, that is the so-called barrier that we have to break up. You know, we aspirants have to break up that barrier
between people and bureaucracy. So when they see a future, you know, civil servant interacting with them, they feel really, you know, they feel special. They feel, array, there's something special in me that, you know, this guy has actually spoken to me. So that actually uses my pressure. That is my way of doing it. You might have different ways of using off your pressure. Some people like listening to music, which you can't afford to there. But it could be different ways. All I'm saying is that, think of something, do something, you know, create your own. It's like watching the movie Inception. They have a totem at the end. Same way, you have to have your own idea to ease off pressure. So if you do that, you will manage to cover up those 5 minutes. So after that, I was called 5, 10 minutes, which felt like eternity. I was called into the room. So I was wearing a light colored coat. So I had this thing in my mind that if I wear a dark colored coat, which most of the people would, okay, one, I wouldn't stand out. Two, light color is always soothing for your eyes. Yes or no? Now, these two facts are irrelevant, totally irrelevant, but they help me feel confidence. Understood? That is the most important part. Some people might say when you speak, you shouldn't move your hands a lot. I have this habit of moving my hands a lot. So one or two mock interviews, they told me, don't do this, Ramit, it's very bad. But I don't know, I felt that suggestion is wrong. Because this is my personality. When I speak, if I move my hand, and if it helps me to express myself better, why shouldn't I? I'm not hurting anybody as such, nor am I stating anything incorrectly. This is my way of speaking, that's all, okay?
So
when you sit for your mock interviews also,
always remember, you should be smart enough to identify which is a good suggestion, which is not a good suggestion,
okay? That is very important. So my interview began, so I was wearing a very light colored suit, I wished them good morning. I had a clean shaven. I didn't have a beard or anything. I cut short my hair. Till now, I used to have very long hair for my FC and all. Can I cut it out? Anyway, so I went there, you know, with the belief that if I, you know, if I'm, you know, clean shaven, they might feel I'm a kid. I'm a 20-year-old. So UPSC always has this thing for young people because we are all filled with boiling blood, you know, wanting to create a revolutionized radical India. You know, we can change the, you know, entire country into beautiful America. Whatever. Anyway, so I went in, I said, you know, we're still good morning, and they asked me to sit down. And first question itself, she pushed me to the corner. So UPSC again had this thing that UPSC doesn't like people
who simply prepare for 2, 3, 4 years and write the exam. Because anybody can clear the examination like that. If you clear in your first attempt, well and good. If you don't clear in your attempt, first attempt, UPSC would accept, forgive you if you give your second attempt without working anywhere. That's the idea. So for a first attempt, you need not work. You may, you know, focus entirely on preparing for the exam. Second attempt, again, it's okay. It's forgivable if you don't work anywhere, but you prepare. But if you don't clear the second attempt also, in your third attempt, UPSC expects you to look for other means of job, and then along with that, prepare. Because the idea is that anybody can, you know, sit and study for 3, 4, 5 years, even with somebody with a below average IQ, and clear the examination. Yes or no? Correct? By the way, feel free to, you know, raise your hands and cut me off quickly and ask any questions. So, this is exactly what I did. Okay? This is exactly what I did, wherein I didn't have a job. I had a job which I gave up, and then I prepared the first attempt, I didn't do a second attempt again. Third attempt again, I didn't have a job, but I was prepared. But I had this thing in my mind that if I don't get my third attempt, I'll look for a job and then prepare. I didn't want to give up, that was for sure. Luckily, I managed to clear my third attempt. The first question she asked me, okay, Ramit, what have you been doing all these years? So that kind of question. That's all, but it was really crazy.
Anyway, what have you passed out of college in 2014, so what have you been doing all these years?
So I understood what she meant, okay? See, this is very important. She may have asked you a question, but she means something else. Understood? It's always like that. By the way, my chairperson was Mr. Pita Narayan. She's also from Tamil Nadu. And I was also. So this is the question. So I understood what she basically means. Okay, it's been 3, 4 years, what have you been doing all these years? So I understood, so I wanted to prove that, ma'am, I am competent enough. It's not that I didn't get a job, okay, but it's just that I wanted success. So I told, ma'am, I got 4 campus institutions when I was in my college in 2014, but I did not want to enter the IT industry. That is the reason I decided to appear for civil services. So she was impressed, as in at least partially. I think that made my point, that this is the reason that, you know, I haven't been working. This basically means that I had a job, I was capable of getting a job, but I chose not to get it. Not to take it, sorry. Then
came the
toughest question of my entire process, which was also the best for me.
So I had this habit
before I went for my mock and all, I used to write deep copy in my hand, just to, you know, make myself feel confident. That's all.
You can do all sort of things, whatever it is. So I wrote
B copy in my hand. So the next question and my answer was to be that. So she asked me, so you had a job but you didn't take it. Do you regret not having work experience? So I said, ma'am, the very fact that I'm sitting right in front of you means that I don't regret it. The entire batch was, the entire panel was
a little bit
taken aback that I will give such an answer. It sounds very nice when I speak up like this right now. But over there it sounded very confident and cocky. But I didn't realize it. Later on when I thought about it, that's when I realized it was very cocky. And the entire board started laughing. And suddenly I felt, okay, you know, these people laugh. Thank God. So then they said, okay, fine. But then she asked a few questions. I'll send you the transcript, ma'am. I won't have the transcript. You can read through the transcript. Lasted for almost 45-50 minutes. And she asked me a few questions here and there. I answered. From then on, I knew it was uphill, nothing downhill. Because I was lucky enough to have
that one question,
one striking question at the very beginning of an interview. One of the most important things that you need to understand is that even if you have to ask 20-30 questions, you just need to strike one question for gold. That's it. Even if you answer no for the entire duration of the interview, that's it. One question, if you impress the entire board, that's it. So wait for that question. I was lucky to get that question in the very beginning. Some people may get it at the very end. Some people may get it liberally. Understood. So that all depends upon, I mean, I'm a person who doesn't believe in luck, but still, it will depend upon your luck. Okay? Like I said, we have the power to sway the interview the way we want it. So if you always have the power. Trust me, you always have the power. If you believe so, you do so. Correct? So wait for that one or two questions where you can strike gold. Okay? And if even it doesn't matter whatsoever what kind of an answer you give for the others, as long as it's not, you know, rubbish in some sense. Okay? So always take a very, as far as possible, take a very mediocre stand. Okay? Because you're bureaucrats at the end of the day. You're not expected to take radical views. You're not expected to be revolutionary, you know, per se. Or you're not so expected to take extremist views. And in general also, if you look at it, in life it's always good not to have extremist views. Okay? Even if you're extremist, even if you're orthodox minded, even if you're conservative, it does not matter, actually. Okay? And there's nothing wrong in that. That is the most important part. You're all humans, we all have emotions, we all have opinions. Okay? So even if let's say, you are a believer in one particular religion, and the person sitting opposite is an atheist, who is right or wrong in this? Nobody. Okay? The atheist wants to believe, does not want to believe in God, the other person wants to believe in God. That's all. There's nothing wrong, right or wrong in this. So as a bureaucrat, when you sit there in front of the UPSC panel, that is what they expect. They expect you to have an opinion. One of the questions, like one of my hobbies was reading historical fiction. Because I write short stories. So I write, actually, even when I write short stories, I focus on, you know, mixing history with, you know, fiction into it. So one of my hobbies was reading historical fiction. So that was, you know, that was a positive aspect for me, because that is when Padmavati movie was, you know, it was hot in the debates. So one of the members asked me very seriously, they asked me, okay, I can see in your dash that reading historical fiction happens to be your hobbies. So do you think, what is your take on Padmavati? Isn't it a very rubbish movie? He actually used the word rubbish, and I was a little taken aback. I didn't expect them to use such harsh words in a UPSC formal interview. So I was a little taken aback, but I stood firm. And they asked me, isn't it rubbish? They actually hurt the feelings of people. They should have, you know, freedom of the press should not be violated like this, etc., etc. So I said, sir, I totally respect your feelings. I took a very neutral stand, but at the same time, I had an opinion. I said, in India, the constitution is the first religion. Yes or no? Correct? So as per the constitution, we have the freedom of the press, we have the freedom of speech and expression, everything. Okay? But at the same time, they are also subject to reasonable restrictions. Yes or no? So forget reasonable restrictions. Even if we say that freedom of the press is equal to liberty, that is, it's absolute. Even then, as human beings, as Indians, as other Indians being our fellow brethren, are we not supposed to respect others? So if I make a movie, it's my equal responsibility to make sure that I don't end up hurting the religious sentiments of people. India is a country where for people, religion is very, very, very emotionally connected. Yes or no? All of us sitting here, even if a person is an atheist, even for him or her, that person, there will be some source of power which will be very emotionally connected. Yes or no? So America may be a country wherein you can fly, you know, you can burn the American flag. Whereas in India, if you burn the Indian flag, it's not only an offense, but it also hurts us very badly. Very sentimentally it hurts us. Yes or no? That is the reason we are culturally different from a country like America or whatever Western country. So I took that stand. I said, the filmmaker should have made sure that the religious sentiments are not hurt. But at the same time, I stand by my my opinion that freedom of the press remains the fundamental foundation of Indian democracy or Indian constitution. So such questions did come about. There was another question that time Supreme Court had came up with a ruling on liquor shops in and around national highways. So there was a question on that as well, whether it was a good decision. So I felt it's not a good decision, because I said if a person really wants to drink, instead of 50 meters, he or she would obviously choose to drive all the way to, you know, beyond those 50 meters, buy liquor, and then come back to the national highway. And at the end of the day, it's not about national highway per se. The accidents do happen even on rural roads. And the debate went on like that. And there was also a question related to simultaneous elections. in which the board member who asked me that question was in favor of simultaneous elections, but I was not. I was against it. So that member asked me that question, what is your take on that? So I said, I'm against simultaneous elections, and I gave all my justification for that. And then they accepted. They said, okay, fine, I'm not in favor of your opinion, but I'm in favor. This is what the board member said. I'm in favor of simultaneous elections, but I like your stuff. This is what he said. So he didn't say person, but this is what portrayed outside. And also, one more thing, one vital fact that you need to remember is that all of us are humans, right? So we don't have a very large attention span. Technically speaking, one individual will have an attention span of hardly 45 seconds. Maybe at most 1 minute if they are a really good speaker. So whatever you present, make sure that it is concise enough to limit the given content. You can speak on and on and on. But even right now, I've been speaking for the past 15 to 20 minutes. Your thoughts must have wandered for a lot many days. Some of you might have thought of, going for some trip to Goa after your interview, or going home after this examinations. I saw how recently you were reading newspaper right now. All of this does matter, and your minds would anyway wander off. That is true. So this is also a very important thing that you need to remember over there. To take advantage of the advantages that you already have. If you think you are very strong in one particular area, it could be your graduation subject, it could be international relations or whatever it is. You can always drive the interview according to that. So this is very important. And if you have the confidence, I'm pretty sure that is what they want. One more thing I must mention. They expect you to be scared. This is very important. They know you're scared. They've also gone through the same process. Yes or no? It is a UPSC interview. UPSC, that's all the way to Delhi. You might have come from the remotest part of the country. You might have come from Arunachal Pradesh, Kerala, Gujarat, Jammu and Kashmir. And then you're going there for the UPSC interview, competing with what? 2,000, 3,000 odd best students, best minds in the country. Okay? And you're sitting there. How can you be not scared? It's impossible. If you are at all not scared, it's a so-called fear factor is 0%, there's something definitely wrong with you. Yes or no? Correct. So they expect a certain amount of anxiety. Okay? So even I was very anxious when I walked into the room. And they expect that. Okay? And within that time frame, how you handle the pressure is what comes. When you become the district collector someday, you're not going to face, you won't have people to help us. Correct? So when we become a district collector someday, we won't have anybody to help us. Everybody would be against us. So how we handle that pressure is what they try to gauge. And we don't expect us to be 100% perfect. Because that is why we are trained. Correct? They know that we have the potential to be trained. That is what they want. They want us to have the potential. Okay, this person is somebody whom we can train into a good person. That's all. Imagine yourself, and when you walk into the interview room, imagine yourself to be only a salesman. I am a salesman, so I have to answer questions accordingly. That is the most important part. And then, it just goes on. Always remember, it's a very beautiful, beautiful day. For me, it was like that. And even when I walked out of the interview, I was very dissatisfied. I felt there were so many questions to which my answers could have been improved. So many questions. Some of the, like I said, I made a blunder of making a wrong comment on bureaucracy and civil service, which I corrected then and there. When you don't know something, accept it. Don't be fake. Please don't be fake. Please don't try to portray yourself as somebody which you are not. If you are something, just portray yourself, sir, I'm this, but I have the potential. That's all they expect. You should have the potential to be trained into a good civil servant. Just prove to them, sir, and ma'am, I have the potential. I may not be good enough to be a civil servant today, but tomorrow, if you give me the right guidance, I can be one. Okay? So that is all you need to do. That is the way that you need to do. And once you do that, it's child's play in a way forward. You need a lot of motivation for that. And ultimately, I believe, which all of you already know, the biggest source of motivation is your self itself. So if the drive for you to be a civil servant is strong enough, so I guess there won't be any hurdles as such. I mean, you would face a lot of hurdles, but it's going to be very good. And like I mentioned in the very beginning of my session, always find answers to your own problems yourself. That way, it wouldn't feel as if it's being imposed upon you. So even if you go for mock interviews and you can make suggestions upon it, like you shouldn't do this or you should do this or you should take certain time, evaluate yourself whether that suggestion is correct or not. Understood. That is the best way. So tomorrow, when I appear for my examination again and when I go for my interview, there is no guarantee that I will, you know, I can score about 200. There is no guarantee as such. But I have the confidence that I can perform that. Whatever marks they give me, that's the future. I can't predict it. But I have the confidence that, okay, if I go there, all I have to do is, because I already have an experience, I know that I want to perform well. I want to
speak. He is the son of.
Because I love talking. I don't know whether people like it when I speak, but because I love talking, I know I'll speak. That is for sure. Whatever questions that they ask, I'll answer them. That is for sure. And if I don't know an answer, and I won't be fake. That is for sure. If I had wanted to create a fake image over there,
but if you have both,
my 206 would have been 106. 100%. Sure. So the worst thing that can happen in your UPSC interview is when you try to create a fake image of yourself. Okay? Or lie. Don't lie also. Don't lie. That is the same as being fake. So that is the whole idea, and they expect to sound something. They always expect people who are driven by, you know, that wild blood people who want to create change. Because 5 years, 10 years down the line, we all know, you know, what happens to bureaucracy. We all go down the drain and we feel, array, nothing is going to happen. Ye to chalta hai, the so-called chalta hai. But let's hope that doesn't happen. Let's all hope that doesn't happen. But when we sit there, they will want us to. Because for instance, I had a dear friend, I wouldn't want to name it because he had a garbage. He is in the IPS, he's very senior to me. I met him during my formation course. He's a Malayali, so very close friend of mine. He bonded very quickly during the FC days. So he said, dude, you are in the IRS, I am the IPS. Please, if there is any chance, I would like to exchange the service. Because he doesn't like that, he's not happy with that service. So it depends from person to person. Some people may not like it. For instance, I'm in the IRS and I aspire to be in the IRS. And you never know, when I'm already in the IRS, if I manage to clear it in my next attempt, I may not enjoy it. I may not. But I like to believe that I would enjoy it. Okay, that negative side apart. And always, some people, I've always heard a lot of people say that stay away from negative people. My stand would be that people are not bad as people are not bad as such. Very sorry that I only one coffee this morning. Sorry about that. So don't be away from negative people. Tell me which is better, staying away from negative people or being with negative people and converting the negative thoughts of these people into positive thoughts. Which is better? The second one really needs courage. You need courage to convert that. Okay? So accept those challenges that, okay, this is the problem in our society and find the answers. Stop complaining. Please stop complaining. It's high time we all take up responsibility. We don't have the time or the resource or the energy to complain. Whatever the energy we expend on complaining can be used positively for other aspects. So stop complaining. And I'm not saying that I don't complain either. I complain. Okay? But even when I complain, very quickly somehow I manage to realize, self-realize that, okay, dude, you've been complaining all this while. It's high time you move on to the other place which you like. So I like the non-complaining part. So the sooner you realize, the better. The more time you spend in the complaining part, the more energy you waste. Literally waste. Okay? So that is the whole idea about the interview process. And please don't have any fear as such. Convert those fear into anxieties. Anxiety is a much positive word than fear as such. And you'll enjoy. All those first timers. Veterans would already know how the process is. You've already spoken about that. I really hope you can score. Crossing the 200 is not a very tough part. But 150 to 200 is also not tough. It's always about how you present yourself there. And over a period of time, you won't even realize how your personality has improved. And during my mock interviews, like I said initially, some of my mock interview comments were that I'm very pleasant to talk. So I didn't know that till then. Okay, I didn't know because I don't know, I was probably oblivious about that, oblivious of that fact. So I'm not praising myself right now. I'm just saying something I realized during the mocks, which I didn't know about myself. Okay, even my friends didn't tell me. So such aspects can be borrowed or can be accepted, can be learned rather from your mocks, from interactions with your friends. Sit with your friends also and ask yourself questions. Okay. More often than not, what I found is that when you sit with your teacher, fellow aspirants who are also appearing for the interview, you argue with them. Don't argue, take up that stand.
If that person has a particular view,
try to understand the source of that.
Why is the person feels so and so? For instance, capital punishment. If you feel that, heinous crimes should be given capital punishment, why so? I personally am against capital punishment,
okay, even for the worst heinous crimes. Okay? Because I have my own justification for that. But that does not mean that the person who believes that he is capital punishment is wrong, is it?
No, it's not. Correct.
So, when you sit with your fellow aspirants,
have a very positive debate.
Don't argue with that person. If that person feels so, then you should understand why is it that that person feels so and I don't have that thought. Okay? That must be some reason why you don't feel like that. So, keep asking questions like that. That's all. Even the meeting,
spend a lot of time on meeting. That might help.
Okay? Go for the meetings. Okay? Like, please, this, please, that. And one most important part, start with yourself. If I ask you this question, this is what I always tell in your sessions.
If I ask you, who is
your great-grandfather or mother, how many of you have any friends? This is your group. I'm not asking you to be Ugandan president or a Myanmarian president. I'm asking you to be great-grandfather or your mother, your great-grandmother. This is your group, okay? Adding the ground value is probably easier to answer. So if you don't have such roots, I don't know. I come from a middle-class family, so for me it is like that. But I already knew this. So one of my friends actually asked me this question, did it like and I knew the answer. She was like, you already know about yourself. You already know certain roots, your own family roots, which is good. I'm not saying that is what took you to a good, really good score. All I'm saying is that know yourself.
Start off with knowing about yourself.
If you come from a particular school, know about that. When was the school started? So even if you don't answer that question, like the precise year when that particular school was started, you can at least say, okay, my school started maybe somewhere around the 1960s, but I don't remember the exact year. But if they ask you, let's say, who is the current president of Sri Lanka, and if you don't know the answer, they'll say, okay, fine, it's pardonable. Understood? It's pardonable. But if they ask you about your father's own degree, and if you don't know that, which college you studied from, that is wrong. Correct?
That is something. That's a big flaw. That's a flaw in you, proper flaw in you that you don't know about. So these are the flaws that you need to rectify before you walk into the UPSC interview room and hope that the questions are very favorable to you. Hope to the fullest. Be confident. I think that should be. That's more or less the whole idea of what the assignment test is. So all those first timers here, my message to you would be that it's a very beautiful day. Wait for that day. Okay? Really
wait for that day. Just to ask yourself, why isn't the day yet? Why hasn't the day come yet? And
you'll find all the answers.
You may not find all the answers in one day, or 2 days, or 1 week, or 1 month, but eventually you will. So keep asking questions. Asking questions itself is a good thing. And when you interact with them, there are certain things, there are certain mannerisms that you should not avoid.
For instance, when you speak to them, have a certain respect to them. So if somebody says you're wrong, don't argue with that person. Say that, sir, I'm not wrong, I'm right.
But if you
say, sir, I this is the way I think.
I always think that I'm right. But if you think that I'm wrong, I'll think about it. So that's all. Okay. So give a certain respect to them. And there are small nitty-gritties when you how to impress them. For instance, when you answer, let's say, the second panel member, try to quote what the first member said. So when you say, like he rightly said, so we'll feel good. Understood. We recommend your name for 2 or 6 when he speaks to the UPSC chair. These are like small nitty-gritties that you need to work upon. Okay? If I say, for instance, you definitely wouldn't know the names of people, but like I said, it's like remembering names. Okay? If I ask you, what's your name?
Stalin.
So if I, 1 year later, when I meet Stalin, if I say, hey Stalin, what's up? He would feel really good. He would say, good God, Ramit, he remembered my name. Whereas I had met him last year. Same way, if somebody remembers my name, I would also feel good. Yes or no?
Correct. It's all about a sort of ego massaging. Okay? So people, and it's a positive ego. Don't take it negative. Ego itself is not a negative.
Male, and he's delivering the statement.
We are all power mongers. Yes or no? We are all power mongers in one way or the other. So it's all that ego that has brought us here. So massage that ego as possible, and you will feel good. And don't take it negatively. Okay? That's it, I guess. Any questions? Feel free Ask me anything. I'm all open.
My name is Ashok. Ashok Kerala. So, answer consistently for the Christians. There should not be a contradictory answer to one question on one point and for the other question.
Now, how to develop that for the next 1 or 2 months? How to
create that? Very good question. So the point is that having a philosophy of life is very important, first of all. Don't be driven by principles as such. Okay? And by the way, whatever I speak to you today in this forum, it's not absolute. Okay? You will have your own life. You will have your own principles. You will have your own thoughts. So whatever I speak out here, just take them as inputs and then process them in your mind and then come out with an output. Mine is not an absolute statement. Okay? I'm not God. God is only absolute if you are a theist. Okay? So coming back to your question, have a philosophy of life, very good question. You'll always have controversies. For instance, let me speak on capital punishment that I already spoke of. When I say that I'm not in favor of capital punishment, is it a conservative answer or is it a liberal answer? Liberal?
Yes.
Because I'm not in favor of it. Now when it comes to Shabrimala issue, if I say that women should not be allowed to enter because you're hurting the custom, the religious custom that has been being followed for years and centuries in Kerala, so it should not be allowed. What about that? Is that conservative or liberal?
Conservative
or orthodox statement? Isn't that a contradiction of thought? So in one stage, I took a very liberal stand. On the other stage, I took an exact opposite stand. So such questions you might not even realize. You might realize this only when you're sitting over there. That is why I keep asking you to think. Even when you read papers, you don't just read and, this is a phase wherein you need to forget about facts. You need to forget about facts. Instead, you need to read the paper and understand how to make an opinion on something. Okay? Okay, let's say, could you show me the paper, somebody? This is the front page. We have seen protests marked Kerala Harkal, sample of remarks, every 7 years, like reduction minors, silence. Okay, start off with Kerala Harkal only. Okay? So Kerala Harkal, just Harkal, take Harkal as such. Would you support a Harkal? This is the first question. Okay? Would I support a Harkal for a common, for a really good cause? Okay? Had it been, had this Harkal been driven by non-violence, it would have been a good message. Yes or no? But at the same time, actually done. I mean, I don't know how hard stricken Harkals are in Tamil Nadu, but in Kerala they are really bad. Closes do not open at all. You might know. So, if that something like that happens, what is the opinion that I would take? Okay. If remember when the famous Delhi gang rape happened back in 2012, there was actually a protest. Yes or no? So which actually kind of shut down all the roads and all the shops. Wasn't it for a just cause? Yes or no? But at the same time, there were always different views to protest against it. Correct. It was a good protest, okay? But I'm only looking at the alternatives, that's all. I'm not saying the protest was bad. And I totally support the protest. Because we were really hurt. Our own system was brutally, hurt that way. So we were hurt, so we had the right to protest like that against the government. So when you read something like that, rather than simply reading, okay, there was a Harkal in Kerala because of so-and-so issue, so-and-so happened and so-and-so parties were the ones who were supporting the Harkal. Rather than that, remember or try to understand what is the opinion that I would take had I been in that position, had I been the political party leader who took that decision to call for a Harkal, what would I have done? And had I been a commoner, which I am, a commoner now, how would I react against it? Okay. So that is how we begin. So when you come across all such questions, eventually the number of contradictions would come down. At the end of the day, there would always be contradictions in our mind. It's like that. Because at the end of the day, we are humans. We all have emotions. We all have thoughts. We all have the seven sins in us. Yes or no? We are not perfect. We all have those seven sins. I hope you know what the seven sins are. We all have that seven sins. So enjoy those emotions. But even when you enjoy those emotions, understand that these contradictions can have answers. So evaluate yourself, stand, make an opinion for yourself. That would you know, cut down as many contradictions as possible. But it's not possible to have absolutely zero contradictions. That's all. Okay. So keep thinking, and you know, when such questions come, and try to analyze what is the stand that you will take. Okay.
Thank you, sir.
Luckily, I didn't get that question because it's the toughest question. We really don't know how to introduce that part. But when you are asked to introduce yourself, Purna, always focus on the matter which is not there in the DAF. Okay? Whatever is there in the DAF, let's say you have, you know, your degree, this and that. Start off with your name. You know, that and all is fine. Okay? We won't bother, you know, if you repeat some part. But always try to look at it in such a way that which would impress them. For instance, if I say, I might start off saying that, you know, my name is Ramit, that I would anyway say. But from then on, I would say I was, you know, like I said, I introduced myself by saying that I'm basically from Kerala, but I was born and raised in Delhi, okay? Which is actually written in my DAF, because my DAF says that my school is St. Columbus in Delhi. But when I say I was born and raised in Delhi, it's a different way of putting it. You know, wherein I say that my roots have come from Kerala, but I was born and raised in Delhi, so indirectly I'm telling them that I have a Delhi mindset. Yes or no? Correct. So that cultural difference is already set upon them. Okay. So I'm also giving them an impression that, okay, I come from a metropolitan city, you know, perhaps the most metropolitan in India, and hence my thoughts would also be that way. Okay. Then you can go, okay, you know, this is what I did, and you know, I've always wanted to prepare for civil services because, you know, I'm a little bit into social service. You know, don't go and say over there, ki, I want to, you know, work for India, you know, eradicate poverty. I mean, all of that is there, but you don't need to explicitly state that. So people might get offended if you repeat the same old cliched stuff over there. But instead,
point
photograph, maybe you can even speak of the philosophical aspects. Like he said, we all need to have some philosophies. Yes, correct? We all need to have some philosophies of life. So you can speak of those.
She is the only
change, you know,
daughter.
I've always believed it like that. And then you could quote
the
some
father,
examples. For instance, I believe in change, and that is
mother.
Why when the recent Sabarimala issue happened, I wanted to support.
How was X is related to the person in the photograph?
So, see, okay. You're linking
so
it.
So immediately
consider
I am X.
Interview towards a topic which you're confident of. You're getting it.
My mother is my grandfather.
I spoke of you know, my viewpoints, my mindset, and I put forward a current hot debate topic.
Now the sentences,
he,
she
one
is
of
the
them at least would,
only
you know, catch hold of that and maybe ask questions on that. So if you're good at it, okay, don't make
mother.
The blunder of, you know, pinpointing something that
grandfather
is
having only one.
There, you know,
she is my
you
mother.
Don't have much
okay.
Content. Content is the right word for that. Okay, so that is very important. So I hope Purna have answered.
How?
Okay.
X.
Is that okay?
Who? The person. The photo person. So the person who is there in the photo is mother. So which means X is. Son.
Definitely get questions from
the
so
the first
question, that is for sure. Pakka sure, anyway. I didn't get a question. That strong? I wasn't strong. I was only strong in the practical part. I was really not good in theory. Yeah. Engineers, please answer that. Okay? We're generally the opposite. Are you not an engineer? So you would know that. Okay, anyway, go on. I hope this is good. Yeah, please.
So
sorry. See, if you mean to say if you're not strong.
Yeah.
Oh, if you're not strong. See, if you're not strong and if they ask you questions related to something, let's say if you're from chemical engineering and if they ask you about some, if it's chemical engineering, they might ask you about anything. Correct. Okay. So if
ninth one, I'll tell you later. What is the answer for the ninth one? Mother, right?
Up.
Okay. Let it be. Ninth one, I'll tell you later. Tenth one.
But this is what I know. Understood. If it's
father
related to something, if you directly don't know the question, the answer to that question, just straight away say, sir, I don't know the answer to that question, and then just play it along, and then you know, add something. But sir, I know about this, and then keep on speaking till they stop you. Understood. Till they stop you. If they stop you, don't speak further. Please don't make that mistake, okay? And don't speak when the other person is speaking. That is a sort of disrespect. As simple as that. If I am speaking, if I gave you the permission to stop me midway, why? Because I told you so. Correct. Had I not told you so, and had you stopped me, I wouldn't have felt offended. But some people do get offended. Correct. Okay. So we have to play with people's emotions as well. So if a direct question is asked on a factual question, and
so see, my mother
when I said
is having
45 minutes, okay, if or 30 to 45 minutes.
So who is my
there will come points
mother's grandson?
Even we are low.
Maybe my
energy.
Son,
correct.
Right?
Okay. And if you or feel that low, and if you don't
my
feel
sister's
like speaking,
son,
just stick with. I'm sorry, sir. I don't know the answer. And just wait. That's all. There are often people who make blunders wherein they say, oh, I'm sorry, sir, I don't know the answer. And then they wait. And they wait for the entire panel may keep their mouth shut. They might keep mum. They might not say anything. And that's actually a trap. They want to see whether you open your mouth again. Okay? You know, enjoy that silence. Just stay there. Okay? Enjoy that silence and look at them. Give them a smile. Hi, how are you? You know, that sort of a smile. Okay? Within them and within yourself. And just stay there. So the answer to your question would be, so whatever that question is, what is your graduation, what engineering? Mechanical. So they might ask you, you know, what is the difference, how does a, you know, a four-stroke engine, or how is a four-stroke engine different from a two-stroke engine? As simple as that. This is a very basic question to which you are supposed to know the answer. Okay, that is, don't make a blunder of not being able to answer such questions. Like if they ask me what is, I'm a computer science engineer, if they ask me what is an operating system, and if I don't know the answer, that is... like, you know, which means I paid money to clear the examination. As simple as that, okay? I'm supposed to know that. So, four-stroke, two-stroke is a very question. So, you could like, go, for instance, if that is a question, what is the difference between four-stroke and two-stroke? You might start giving examples, maybe move on to Volkswagen, you then move on to F1, because I follow F1, okay? I'm really fond of driving. So, see, you move on to F1 and then say that, sir, I love driving, I would like to be, you know, I've always been very fond of how Michael Schumacher drives, Lewis Hamilton drives, etc., etc. So see, I've already brought in points from where they can speak, they can catch hold of me. And F1, I'm pretty sure, is not a topic that they have much, you know, with due respect. Majority of the seniors don't really follow F1. It's like a youth thing. So, but if it is, it's a good thing also. So if you have a strong point, really hope that the person, the panel member, also has a strong point in the same area. Only then it's advantageous you. If it's an area to which they don't have any idea about, like I earlier mentioned about Abraham Wren, most probably what you're going to expect is she or he googling it up and asking questions to which you also don't know answers to, unless you're lucky, very lucky. Understood? So that way you can deviate the interview. Okay? Huh. Your name is?
Jagan.
Jagan. Acha, tell me.
When you have said that drive a particular interview in the direction to which you are not fit, when you bring an action in the panel, like to say, like, I can answer a question, so that it's like playing a trap, so they ask me the second question.
Correct, correct.
In such a way that you are like, say, for example, let's say like F1 race itself, you answer it in such a way that, okay, fine, you make them ask why is that F1 not so popular in India, or like there are very few things, or like to ask a question where you were prepared, the second part of the question, which we don't know what it is, but this is based on your answer. I'm asking, like, did you prepare it mentally, saying like, okay, whenever there's a question like this, I am going to say this, so that they're going to ask me the second question, just a hope. Or were you just natural that, okay, fine, whatever they ask, I could always be like witty enough to bring that?
Good question. My answer to that is both. So I have this, because like I said, I love talking. So
if
I have
I
a certain
this,
part of me
they
which
are
can
they
take
be
the
husband
conversation
and wife.
Forward. Okay?
If I use
I can, like,
plus
keep,
symbol,
keep on talking,
then
talking
they are
for long hours. Okay. But at the same time, there was a certain amount of preparation also on my part. Wherein, see, you know, your homework right now should be, rather than simply mugging up facts, like I said, you know, jot down all the topics that have been there in current affairs recently. Okay? So all the topics that have been there in recent past 3 to 4 months. Okay? They are not going to ask you about, you know, what has happened like 10 years back or 1 year back, last prelims. You know, I wouldn't personally suggest that. What I would suggest is go through the relevant topics in today's current affairs, and then when you jot it down, let's say Hartal, for instance, or you know, all Malayalis can expect questions from floods also, because it recently devastated Kerala. So whatever the question is, so you should have a stand on that. So take that particular topic and kind of make a list of all the questions that are probable from that particular area.
This is very important. This is how you deal with everything. This is what I did also. You take a topic and you may preferably sit with somebody else, because 2 months are always better than one. Okay? So you will have the list of almost equivalent maximum list of questions that are problems from one particular area. So once you get all the questions, don't write down the answers. Just the questions. Okay? Once you get all the questions, then try to evaluate. Every question may have a different answer, even if it's, you know, somewhat similar. Similar does not mean same. They're different. So when you have a particular question, let's say, you know, again coming back to Hartal, the question could be, are Hartals relevant in 21st century India? One. Okay. Another question could be, how different are Hartals in India today than the Hartals which were conducted by Mahatma Gandhi back before India's independence? Two questions, correct? But both questions can have similar answers. Yes or no? You can answer the first question with content that you could have used in the second question. Yes or no? Am I making the point clear? So the content would be somewhat similar but not same. So you can drive it if you want, if you're good in history, and you can bring these equal protests and, you know, all those matter that was covered with written journal and history books, you can sway this question into the second part. Understood? So this is how you drive it. So if you're really good in history, and if you want the crowd, the so-called panel, to, you know, ask you questions related to it. If you mention Gandhi, if you mention Ambedkar, Nehru and all that, you're pretty sure you'll get questions from that area. 100%. Because history is everybody's favorite. Okay? History is unlike mathematics or economics or any other subject, because everybody knows partial history, for sure. And people can ask questions from anywhere. So you can do that. So that is what you do.
Say, like, for example, like, there would have been questions where you would have already prepared for it. Say, where you've already prepared for it, so you have an answer ready-made for it. Do you just jump the gun and just start pouring it out? Or you be very cautious about, like, okay, fine, like, I just have to maintain this thing, like, okay, just listen to the question properly, take a pause or something, just playing around there. And one more thing is that, like, say, like, you had, like, 20 questions, and you would have had, like, 3 or 4 questions where you would have already prepared, like, somewhere in between, like, anywhere it could be. And those answers are pretty good. And you somewhere seem to be, there's not much consistency. Do you think that actually affects? Or just
in
your answering?
Say, like how you mentioned contradictions?
No, not just the contradictions. The 3-4 questions that you've already prepared, you just answer them brilliantly. And other questions, probably very mediocre, like, or like something which not even the standard that they've expected. Because these questions raise the standard and the other questions just put it down. So in these cases, like, okay, fine, like, how do you maintain it? Or, like, or even if you have an answer ready-made, like, how do you just put it saying it's very natural?
Okay, so I would like to answer this question with what I said earlier, that all you actually need to wait for is those 2 to 3 questions that you strive for. Once you should be smart enough to understand and involve this strive for. That is very important. You should know where you stand. If you know that the interview is going downhill, it means that you need to pick up pace. You need to pick up pace somewhere. So, like I said, if you are lucky enough like me that, you know, you struggle at the very beginning of the interview, then from there it will only be uphill. So even then, if you are not consistent, which will anyway happen. You can't be consistent throughout the interview. You can't be good enough. You know, you can't hit a 6 in every ball. Can you? No, right. So even if you hit 4 sixes, and unless you are relaxing and playing slow and broad in that particular world, then you are lucky. You will have to defend the last 2 balls, somehow, depending upon the ball. So when that happens, okay, even playing defensive is okay. You know, when they ask you something, you might even speak out something blunder. Like I did, like I said, I'm a power of you. How can I not know the difference between symptoms and bureaucracy? Okay, it was under pressure. That time I was under pressure. I was a little bit pushed to the corner, and got the answer wrong. And it was a lady member, and she said, isn't this the other way around? I was lucky that she actually corrected me. That's when it struck me that I was wrong. Okay? So even when you're not consistent, just be okay. Be fine with it. So it's all, at the end of the day, it's a mental game. Okay? So even if you come across a question for which you've already prepared, okay? Like for instance, for me that question I had already prepared, and during my first or second mock, I don't remember precisely, but during that mock when I had come across this question, I took a different stand than what I had taken in my actual interview. Then I made corrections to it, because that particular mock was early in my preparation period, in the sense, immediately after the basic review. So that thing is very important. Pause, speak. Call, speak. Do not jump the gun. It is very important. Very beautifully put forward by Jaren. That when you speak, don't jump the gun. First of all, wait. Okay. Even if you have bullets ready, just wait. Okay. Let them be in that place and let them know that I have prepared everything. But I'm putting it forward in a very mild manner. Okay. So when that happens, they also see that you are quite mature. Actually, mature is the right word. If you are an immature person, you would want to do everything in high level. Whereas if you are a very mature personality, you would give an impression that, okay, even when, it's like saying, how many of you have followed tennis? Have you seen the difference between how Djokovic and Federer react to a match? Federer is a very mature individual, okay? He doesn't react, you will feel very bland in him. He just won the champions, French Open or the Wimbledon, and he's still standing there, yeah, I won, that's it. Whereas Djokovic would, jump around, going there, kissing his mother and, clapping with his own fans. So he has a lot of, that's not mean that he's immature. I'm just saying that he has a lot of, there's a difference. Maturity and immaturity are two different things. But being mature and being slightly down that particular line is also different. I hope you get the difference, okay? So being a little bit calm and composed also makes a very positive impression. Ultimately, it's about taking the impression. So, like you said, not consistent, just keep your calm and composure when you're ready and stay. Don't give me the feeling that, okay, I'm anxious and I'm a little bit scared, but I'm not going to be one. Second, when you eventually come across a question which you've already prepared, you should definitely ask. Because questions are going to be very regular, okay? Very regular. So when you come up with a question, just wait, okay, be very, very calm. And you may even ask, even if you already know the answer, you might play the trick of saying that, sir, I would wait half a second, 30 seconds. Then, maybe like chit-chatting with them, where you already know I'm going to speak the same thing, but giving them a question like, and then, eventually you speak up. This is how you play the, mental game. You give them the impression that I'm thought, I'm a thinking person, they're a thinking hat. So that kind of gives an impression. I actually went for one, that's the one question. But I actually didn't know the answer. I mean, I knew the answer, I had to think. I think it was for the little one of question. When I was like confused, what should I say? How should I put it forward? I was looking for words. I already knew the answer. But I was searching for those words, how to put it forward. This is also very important. Like I said, if I speak out some particular word and I don't want them to go into that area, I would naturally not speak that out. So I'm searching for those good enough words that would keep me, one foot ahead of my opponents there. Okay, if you want to look at them like that. Okay. I hope that answered. Others? How many of you are really excited to, wait for the interview? One person. That was very good that you raised your hand.
How many of you are
listening,
got interviews from, I don't know. My mocks have not been doing well, but I have a lot of pressure. I have to prove myself to the society. I want to be the IAS. Is that pressure there? It's all good. All these pressures should be there. Feel those emotions. Enjoy those emotions. These emotions, when you want to clear it, it's going to come back as when you do it.
Your name? Vivek. Huh?
That is why I said, think of them as your grandfather's friends. They are not your friends, right? Okay? You are their friends because of your grandfather. So you will give them a certain respect. So just imagine, you can, kind of put your arm around your grandfather's friends. Yes or no? Correct. It's a very good thing. But at the same time, you're not going to, abuse them. You can abuse your friends. In a friendly manner. You can't do it. You wouldn't probably do that with your grandparents. If you have a kind of friendliness, you give that respect. That is a very deep thought. You have a sort of understanding. So, some people, hard luck to get a board where the chairperson is from the military background. They have a totally different. I personally do not like the idea of a non-UPSC, a non-civil service engineering chairperson. Because they wouldn't be able to do it. Absolutely not. That is not the idea. UPSC civil service are totally different from military personnel. I am personally against that idea. Because the whole point is that when they gauge us,
okay? They want a lot of discipline. They want us to be right side of the road, right side of time and function. This is not really that. This is really what you prove today. They would be, you know, very, very hard, you know, you have this hard and fast freedom, you need your time, you should be, you know, you should have a certain, if you ask a military person, what is the solution to India-Pakistan, they say, nuke it, nuke Pakistan. Is that the solution? No, but they would want, they will be very hurt when something like Uri happens. When Uri happens, they would want, you know, we have to take, you know, revenge. We have to, you know, burn them down. That's not the solution. Please don't take that stand, okay? Please don't, you know, say that the final solution to Kashmir is, you know, burning Pakistan down. It's not.
They are our brothers, okay?
They are our own family. They should be like that, okay? Because like Manmohan Singh rightly said, Dr. Manmohan Singh rightly said, neighbors can't be changed. Okay, neighbors are like our own siblings. You can't change your siblings. You can't change your family. So you need to have a good stand on that. So when you take a, when you speak to them, have a sort of respect. At the same time, you know, like when you create a, it's like creating a very amicable situation, a very cordial environment. That comes automatically. You just speak, you know, have a very pleasant face. Just speak to them nice. Even if you're a little scared, tell them that I'm a little bit worried. You know, have express those emotions, and they will understand. Trust me. There will always be situations where you might feel that okay, the interview is not going, you know, down well. That depends upon how, you know, dynamic you are. Ultimately, it's your game. I might speak here for like 10 hours, 15 hours, 20 hours. I might take a lecture for you every day. Or even the UPSC chairperson might come here and tell you, okay, this is what you have to say. But ultimately, you have to say it. Correct? Yes or no? We can only open the door for you. The actual walking part has to come on your side. So when you do that, you would know that you will have your own style. You can't use my style. I can't use your style. Last year's, the first time holder style can't be used by you. I have my own style. So do that, okay? At that moment, and be dynamic, like I said. Okay, some words might not be very cordial in the beginning. So when that happens, just make them believe that, sir, we are here for a very cordial meeting. Or ma'am, we are here for a very cordial meeting. Please don't push me back. Maybe, you know, I would also like to be a part of the UPSC. That kind of image should be created. Understood? That all depends upon how you speak. Okay? One more thing I must tell you, that don't feel bad about this when I say this. Okay? If you're not very strong in your language, okay, especially English, because you'll be giving in your, is there anybody not giving an interview in English? Any other language? No, right? So all of you are giving an interview in English. So if you're not having a good command over the language is actually advantageous. But not having a command is not disadvantageous. You're getting a point? Okay? So that does not mean that you won't get a 2.06. If you're not good in English, it does not mean that you won't get 2.06. But if you're good in English, there is a better chance. That's all. Okay, don't feel bad about that, because ultimately, look at it this way, you're only able to express your views better, as simple as that. That's all, whatever language you are. If you ask me to give an interview in Tamil, I won't be able to do that. I will speak more in Malayalam than in Tamil, because I don't know Tamil that well, okay, though I watch Tamil movies. So that is the idea, okay, so don't feel bad about that, because I know majority of the, because we all come from different backgrounds, and that shouldn't be a barrier in your mental preparedness. That's all. Okay? I hope, Vivek, you got the answer. Yes, Jagan.
You've talked a lot about your mental preparedness. When did you actually think your answer? Yeah, my preparation is done. And say, especially since you're in the middle of your age, we don't know when the age and all that. How do you keep yourself motivated till then? And like, how do you prepare yourself? Because sometimes you just prepare your task and your current affairs pretty much the same. Like, you're going to be asked the same question. To do the same thing, but then sometimes there's actually a case that you actually mentally fatigued. So when you think you're done, okay, fine, I'm done with this, I'm not going to think about it. So a lot of your friends might actually come back and told their experiences and maybe they're starting partying or starting for the next generation or whatever it is. Like, how do you keep yourself motivated?
Good question again. First of all, you're never done. Okay, that is the answer. You're never done preparing. It's like philosophy of life. You're always a student. Okay, you're always a student. Even if you're the best, always have that certain, you know, sense of modesty in you, humility. And this nobody can teach you. Have that feeling that, okay, you know, there are other factors at play. So, you know, even if I'm best, there is somebody better. Correct? There always, even if you clear, even if you secure the first rank, there would be that person outside the list who is better than you. Pakka sure. 100% sure. Write it down if you want. But you won't know who that is. Okay? But there will always be somebody who's better than us.
So we are never done. We are always preparing. Second, when we are fatigued, okay, mentally being fatigued is the worst part, okay? So I had my own, you know, means to like cope up with that. When you're fatigued, you know, you don't have to actually study for like 10, 12 hours a day. You know, I personally don't believe so. To have means to express that grief, it could be either to your mother, your father, have somebody, have that individual with whom you can share whatever you want. I write journals. So you could actually write journals, start writing, make that a habit. It's a very good habit. It makes your mind evolve. Okay, so start writing and then read that like 1 month later and you will feel, what a stupid person I was back then. Why did I even think like this? Okay, or you might laugh at your own, you know, writing. You might feel, it's very funny that I wrote this back then. So this actually helps you evolve. So when you're mentally fatigued, find ways to express your emotions. You could go for a movie, go on a solo trip, which, you know, so if you have some passion, one of the biggest problems with civil service preparation is that we forget all our passions, we forget all our hobbies, correct? And then they make us write, you know, and then we have to make up our hobbies and write it in our DAF. So I know people who have never touched guitar in their life, wrote guitar as their, you know, playing guitar as their hobby, learnt during the, you know, post-mains phase and then went for the interview and, you know, got really good marks. I know people like them. So if you're courageous enough, you can do that. So nothing is impossible. Like I said in the very beginning, whatever I speak here is not absolute. Nothing is absolute, okay? Everything will change. Everything can evolve. So when you are mentally fatigued, I would say, remember what you're doing here. You know, remember what your dream is. Why is it that you're here? You want to, and appreciate life. You know, life isn't as, you know, bad as you think. We all come from different backgrounds. We all have, you know, lows and highs in different parts of life. Some people may be really underprivileged and then they come all over. I have a friend called, I don't know if you've heard of him, his name is Anand Justin. He comes from a very, you know, I'm very close to him. Not like close as friends, but I like him a lot. He comes from a fisherman family. And I really feel bad that he hasn't cleared all this while. And he's way better than I am. Way better than I can be at this point of time. Okay, I can't talk about the future. But he's way better than I am, but he hasn't been able to clear. And every mock he used to prepare much better than me. And look where I did, what I did, and what he did. So he couldn't clear, you know, score really good marks. And I feel bad about that. So there are much better deserving students out there who haven't cleared. So he's the one who deserves it. So I feel that why did I clear and why did... So I appreciate life. Okay, it just happens. We can't really do anything about it. That doesn't mean that, you know, he was bad. He was equally better than me, but he couldn't clear. So such factors will always be at play. To appreciate life like that, okay, there are a lot of factors, you know, at play. And just for a, you know, food for thought, I must put it forward. For instance, let's say if there is, let's say, a heinous crime happening, a rape of a child that happens, also feel that you're also responsible for that. Okay, it's a food for thought. Think about it, you will get the idea. For instance, if a man or if a parent thinks that, you know, or I'm a brother, I don't have like immediate sisters, but I have sisters. If I tell my sister, please don't go out after 8 o'clock or 9 o'clock, it's not safe. It's a bad timing, as they say. Then I'm also equally responsible as the person who commits the crime, who would say that, arey, ye ladki to 8 baje ke baad bahar nikli hui hai, there's something wrong with him, I can, you know, blah, blah, blah. You understood. So my thought or his thought is basically an extrapolation of my thought. Yes or no? It's basically an extrapolation of my thought. So I am also part of that society that kind of let the thoughts revolve around into and they get, you know, got, mine was perhaps for a good intention, but it was wrong. His was wrong and wrong intention. And it was, no, and destructive thought. So I am also responsible for all the crimes that are happening in some way, indirectly. I may not be directly committing the crime, but so this kind of appreciation helps you become a better person. So I'm not saying I'm perfect. I'm no way perfect. But it helps you evolve or, you know, feel that, okay, I'm getting better every day. So that thought is very good. So you keep on evolve, you know, find some means to, you know, express your anger. You know, most cases, like I'm a mama's boy, so I express all my anger on my mother. Okay, then I go and apologize to her. So that's what I usually do. But she knows me. She knows me very well. So I can, you know, blurt out whatever I want to her, then that helps me, especially when I'm under a lot of pressure. So have that one individual if you can do that. And even if that individual is yourself, that will also do, okay? So that is really good.
Sir, like for older candidates, you've also given a number of attempts. That's like structurally against you, like, I mean, you're old and you've prepare only for this. And as you said, you know, they're looking for young and bright people who can be trained easily. And you know, as you get older, there's attitude will change. I mean, like, you get an attitude and it's very hard to train. Probably they think that. How do I go about this? Because I'm one of them.
How old are you?
I'm about 29.
29, first of all, is not very old. Or not at all old at all. Okay? Not at all old at all. Like, I'm 27. Okay? So we all are old. Like, for instance, I'm 27.
I feel, is there anybody who's 22, 23 here? Like, I envy you. I really envy you. I wish I were that age. Okay. Same way you might envy me because I'm 2 years younger than you. So even when I said that UPSC doesn't, or UPSC likes to bring in young people, there is no rule that we don't want like the older candidates, older in, you know, comparative sense, first of all. Secondly, we all have that drive. So at the end of the day, what matters is how you convince them. Sir, we don't even need to talk about age, first of all. Okay, they might not even look at it. But have you been working anywhere? I mean, all these years? But you had worked, no, correct. So see, that is a positive thing. So you can make an impression over there, Arvind, that, see, sir, I was so passionate about civil service that I worked in between, I gave my attempt, then I went back and worked somewhere else, but still I had that drive. That is why I'm still here. It's not all, we all are not, you know, Albert Einstein 160 IQ wala people. Okay, we all have that, you know, 110, 120, some people may be 190 IQ wala people, but ultimately it's that passion that drives it. So all Arvind has to convince the people, the board is that, see, I'm here because I'm passionate about it. I want to bring about the change and I have the potential. Remember, I said, all they need, all they're looking for is that potential in ourselves, you know, irrespective of what our age is, to be molded into the civil servant that they want. As simple as that. So age is not a factor at all. I know people who at the age of 40, I mean, obviously because of reservation, have cleared. 40 and they've cleared. So they know that that person can be molded, okay? But there'll always be a little bit bias in favor of women. Okay, that is obvious. So we should accept that. We should respect that. Okay, and because we want more women to come into service. You know, men are like inherently a little bit evil. You know, women are like much more stable-minded. So that way, it's a good thing. So accept that bias also. Okay, when I argue with my sister, I always tell her this is so unbiased system. I don't have, you know, I have to pay 100 rupees for the examination. You people don't have to pay. You know, how unfair is that? If you want equity, then bring equity in this also. But it's a very jokish debate that I have with my sister, but it's a reality. We need to accept that. Okay, we need to give them the space. Okay, which we have not been giving all these years. So when you convince them, so just now I just justified my stand. Same way, if you convince them, there's not at all a problem. No barrier is insurmountable. Just convince them. Just tell them, sir, this is the case, and they won't even talk about your age. But they'll definitely ask you. They'll definitely ask you, okay, what have you been doing? Like you've had work experience. They might ask you. Like you've had work experience, how is that going to reflect in your civil service career? You know, what is it that you've learned from there, etc., etc. So so think about all these questions and, you know, have a pre-planned answer, but don't blurt it out as if you're vomiting it out. That is bad. Don't, you know, like mug up an answer then go. Just have that idea in your head that, okay, this is the answer that I'm going to speak of, and depending upon the situation, I'll put it forward. As simple as that. Okay. Anything else? Next question. I think this is a bad term. Next question. You have time, right, ma'am? Yeah. Sure. If you people want me to just go through the DAF or something, like, I am most welcome. Two, three, and one, five. You have a question? Yeah. Shall we wind up? Okay, so be passionate about your life. Okay, please enjoy this process. All of you are winners sitting here. Believe that. Okay, you really have put on a lot of effort. You already have the knowledge. They're not looking at your knowledge part, but they're looking at how you put forward that knowledge. That is very important. Just don't expect, sir, I already know the knowledge because I've cleared the examination. But you have to put it forward. Okay, they need to know that you know. They can't assume. You're meeting them for the first time. They are meeting you for the first time in their lives. You can't expect them to know already because I cleared mains. Okay? There are different ways of clearing mains. Okay? So there is no guarantee that it needs to be always because of our knowledge. Okay? So that is very important. and just enjoy that process. Feel that emotion, fear, anxiety, however you want to define it. But eventually you will come on top. So just have that belief, and they'll also believe that, you know, you are the first person who needs to believe that I can do it. Rest automatically. Okay? Okay? So all the very best.